Hello, good morning. How are you? Fine?
Fine.
Okay. Any questions from the previous day? Questions? Suggestions? Okay. First of all, we have to do one thing that we forgot to do the previous day. It is installing RStudio. If you remember, we downloaded RStudio, but we didn't install it. So the first thing that we are going to do today is install RStudio. So please find in your computers the .exe file that you downloaded. It has to be in Descargas, I suppose. The name of the file is this one, RStudio 0.98.1074. And you double click it, and it's going to install RStudio. Okay, so I'll do the same. Welcome to the installing assistant. Next. Next. Install, and in a few minutes I think we will have RStudio installed in our computers, and that's what we're going to use today. If you remember, RStudio is just a graphic user interface for R, so it's the same as R but more friendlier, if you like. It's easier to use R with RStudio than use it alone, so that's what we will do. We will use R with RStudio. Okay, RStudio has been correctly installed in your computer, and finish. And now we should get RStudio, which is here. So if we click on RStudio, we get this interface, which is quite similar to the one we get with R, but we have two more windows here. This is what we get with R. We need R to install RStudio. If you don't have R installed, then RStudio asks you to install R. So we have here what we have with R, but we have two more windows. One with files, some tabs here, files, plus, packages, help, and viewer. We will use them later. And here we have environment and history. The idea is that here we will be able to see every object we have. Do you remember workspaces and histories? Well, here we have the workspace is called environment here. So here we have all the objects that we have defined in R are going to appear here in this window. And then here we have the history of the commands that we have used. And every plot we plot will appear here. Every package we have installed will be here, and we can get help here. So everything is well organized. Not unlike with R, where everything is unorganized and untidy. Here everything is tidy, tidy and organized. Okay, that's the idea behind RStudio. So that's what we're going to use. Okay. Now, we have to review, or we need a summary of last session. So we need a volunteer.
Okay.
A summary from last class.
We see how to implement linear regression.
Linear regression, okay.
That it's a model to try to predict a value depending on some other variables. Mm-hmm. And I don't know.
They are quantitative or qualitative?
Quantitative.
Yeah. The dependent variable, the one we want to predict, is a quantitative variable. And the ones we have to predict, which are called factors, are, it can be quantitative or qualitative. We didn't see it.
Okay.
But they can be either quantitative or qualitative. What else?
We have taken two types of learning
statistical, which is observed and observed. The observed is the one which has models, so it can be
supervised.
Yes, yes. So the supervised will be more or less is more about models, use regressions. So it has more or less quantitative data, while for the other one is use qualitative data. So no need to use the models or regressions. So only just you need to use like clusters, so you can classify the data.
Okay. Yeah. We see two ways of learning. We saw two ways of learning. We saw supervised learning and unsupervised learning. With supervised learning, the idea is that we want a model. We want to learn something to predict, to estimate something. And with unsupervised learning, the idea was trying to find a structure when we don't have a structure. And what else? What else did we see? Linear regression. And we covered also how to estimate the coefficients. Do you remember? Do you remember the difference between parametric and non-parametric methods? Anyone? Any volunteer? Difference between parametric and non-parametric methods? For instance, linear regression was parametric or non-parametric? It was parametric, and why? Why was it parametric? Because we have decided on the functional form of the relationship between the x and the y. We said, well, the relationship between size of a house and the price of the house is going to be linear. We have decided that. So it's going to be a coefficient which is called alpha plus another coefficient which is beta times size. And now our problem has become one of defining or estimating the values for alpha and beta. So it's a parametric problem. If it's non-parametric, then we have not made a decision on the functional form of the relationship. We will cover some of these methods. But from now we're going to cover parametric methods. What else? Then we learned how to estimate alpha and beta. Do you remember this? To estimate beta, we need to compute the covariance between x and y and divide it by the variance of the x. And we get the value for beta. And then using this value for beta, we can estimate the value for alpha. So we have a function that expresses the relationship between price and size. And what else? What did we do after that? We had the function, and then we wanted to measure the quality of the function. Yeah, and what did we compute? Yeah, we computed the R squared, the coefficient of determination. And how did we compute this R squared? Yeah, we compare two models. The model we had, hello, morning, that is a model with size as a factor that explained the price of the house on the one hand, and on the other hand, a model without size. And which is the estimation of the price when we don't have anything to estimate on? We use the average. So we computed two. Do you remember the name for the things that we computed? Two different... two different RSSs. Do you remember? The residual sum of squares. We computed the residual sum of squares for our model, and we computed the residual sum of squares for the model without variables. And which one was the biggest one? Which was the biggest one? The second one. The simpler model has a bigger RSS, always. So we define R squared as what? In which proportion has the RSS reduced from the fact of not having a variable and including this variable in our model. That's the R squared. So it goes from 0 to 1. The bounds are 0 and 1. 0 meaning what? 0 meaning that the model that we have is horrible, is useless. Means that our model is as good as a model that has no variables, so it's useless. And 1 meaning that our model explains perfectly every change in the dependent variable with the changes in the IV, the independent variable. So our model is perfect. And we got a, I think we got a 0.97 R squared. So it was a very, very good model. The one that explains size, sorry, price with size. Okay. Any questions? Okay. So now, everyone has RStudio installed? Well, in Edmodo, you have a file which is called linear regression script or something like this. I think you downloaded it the previous day, but if you didn't, please do now. The name of the script is, a ver, sorry. Yeah, it's this one. A script linear regression 3. Please download it. And we're going to open it. Where is it? I'm going to copy it to the desktop. And in order to use it with RStudio, or to open it with RStudio, I'm going to change the name to its name.r. And this should work. Well, no, it doesn't work. Okay. Doesn't matter. We're going to open it with RStudio. So, if we want to open a script with RStudio, here in the main menu, we do File, Open File, and we want to open this script that we have here. But I want to open it as a script, and I don't know why it hasn't opened as a script. Wait a second, sorry. How can I change the extension of a file with this? I want this to be .r and not .r.txt. What can I do to do that? I'm asking for help.
Wait.
Where? Here?
In the Explorer window.
In the?
In the Explorer window. You open it.
Okay.
And then the Organizar.
Here?
No, menu. Oh,
Organizar.
Opciones de carpeta y búsqueda. Ver.
Ver. Extensiones, ¿no?
Ocultar extensiones por un
Vale. This one. And check this one. Thank you very much. Okay. I want this to be .r. And then I want to change this. and then our studio should open this. Open file, and then our studio should understand that this is a script. Okay, that's the idea. If the extension of the file is .r, then our studio understands that this file is a script. It's a set of commands that we're going to use. So, everyone is here. Everyone has been able to open the script with RStudio and open it as a script. I mean, everyone has here the buttons run, source, and so on. Yes? If you don't have these buttons here, that means that the file hasn't been opened as a script, but as a text file. We want to open it as a script. Okay, so now we're going to follow this set of commands and see what happens. That's the way we perform linear regression with R. Okay, first of all, we need to enter the data. And to do that, we need to, well, we enter data and we create two objects, which are called size and price. So we're going to have an object called size, and that this object will contain the sizes of the houses and price, the prices of the houses. So if we select the first two commands and we press the run button here, what's going to happen? Any idea before pressing the button? Well, these two objects are going to appear in our workspace. You see? Do you see them here? We have created a vector which is called price and a vector which is called size. So here we know which are the objects that we have in the workspace. That's very useful. Now we have defined just these things. Now the next thing, plot size price. Well, the plot command depends on a lot of arguments, has a lot of arguments. But if we write just two vectors, then R understands that size is on the horizontal axis and price on the vertical axis. So if we run this, we're going to get a plot. And the plot appears here. That's the scatter plot. We can improve this plot. This is the simplest version of a plot we can do with R. We can improve it. We could have used a package to create this plot. For instance, ggplot2 is a very famous package to get graphs, to get plots in R. But well, this is a very, very simple one, but that's what we need. Then we have cov and cor. These two commands are going to compute for us the covariance. We know what the covariance is, you remember? Anyone? Anyone? Covariance? It was a measure of the, of what? Yeah, of the linear dependence or the linear association between two features. So if the value is positive, that means that as one increases, the other increases, and if it's negative, means that when one increases, the other decreases. So with this covariance, we're going to get an idea of the linear relationship between the variables. And the covariance is, if we press run, we get here the value for covariance, which is 3702.5. So it's a positive value, and that means that the linear relation is positive. So when one increases, the other increases. And that's what we see here. It's quite clear in the scatter plot that as size increases, the price of the house increases. So everything is correct. The problem with covariance is that it has no bounds. Covariance can move from minus infinity to plus infinity. And that's a problem, because we don't know if this value that we have got here, 1,700 is a big value or a small value. Covariance has no bounds. It will be very interesting to have another coefficient which is bounded, and this coefficient is called the correlation coefficient. The correlation coefficient has the same sign as the covariance, so it gives us the same information. The positive sign in the correlation coefficient means that the linear relationship is positive. The negative sign means that it's negative, so decreasing, but it's bounded. Correlation is always between minus 1 and 1 and plus 1. Minus 1 plus 1. Always there. So if we compute the correlation coefficient and we get a value which is very close to plus 1, then we know that the relationship is positive, and besides, we know that the relationship is very, very strong correlation. There is a very strong linear relationship between these two features. If we get a value which is positive but close to zero, that means, okay, the relationship is positive, but it's not very strong. It's a mild relationship. So we can't say too much on this relationship, okay? So let's compute the correlation coefficient, and here we get, a correlation coefficient of 0.98. So very, very close to plus 1, which means that the relationship between size and price is increasing on the one hand, and on the other hand, very, very strong. Okay? You see that? Perfect. So far, we have computed covariance and correlation. So now we know that these two features are related and are directly related. That means when one increases, the other increases. So now we could say, okay, as we know that they are related, we might use one of them to try to predict or to estimate the other one. If we compute the correlation coefficient and we got here a number which is close to zero, that means that knowing X gives us no information on Y. If we compute the correlation and we got a number which is close to plus 1 or minus 1, that means that knowing X gives us information to compute Y or to estimate Y. So here we have this. We have a very big correlation coefficient. So the message is, knowing X, that is knowing the size of a house, is very good if you want to create a model to estimate the price of the house. Okay, let's estimate this model. And how do we do that? Well, we did the other day. We computed the alpha and the beta. You remember? The beta was covariance divided by variance, and then the alpha was the mean of the average of Y minus beta times the average of X. Okay, to do this with R, we use the LM function. This is the function we use, LM, which means linear model, because linear regression is a linear model. It's one special kind of linear model. So this is the function that we use, LM. Like this, LM. And then we need here at least one argument, which is called the formula that we are going to use. And the formula has always the same aspect. Here we write the dependent variable, the y, then we write this sign, which I don't know how to call it in English. In Spanish it's called virgulilla. Tilde. Okay, thank you. Tilde. And then here we write the x. So in our case, this is called LM, the variable we want, the feature we want to predict, which is price, tilde, and size. And that's what we do here. LM, price, tilde, size. This is a tilde. At least in my computer appears as a tilde here. It looks like a hyphen. but it's a tilde. Okay? And as always,
one question.
Yeah.
Is it case sensitive?
Yeah, of course.
Yes, in there.
Okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah. If you write price with capital P, you will have an error message.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And as always, my recommendation is always to do this and assign the result of what we do to a new object, which, for instance, can be called model number one. Because then, if we just write this, we're going to get some information. Some information is going to be displayed on our screens. But if we assign the results that we're going to keep into this object, are much more than the information that we're going to have displayed on our screens. So always use this command, assign to the object, and then we're going to see what's inside this object. Here, inside this object, we have a lot of information, much more information than the one we're going to get if we just use this command and see what appears on our screens. You understand the idea? So that's what we do here. We use the ln function with price and size, and we assign the results of this function to an object which is called model one. And we press run, and nothing happens. Because R has done what we have asked R to do. He has used the ln function and has assigned the information to the object which is called model one. So now we need to see what's inside model one. And to see what's inside model one, we can use the following function, which is called str. Str is a function that gives us the structure of the object. We're going to see what's inside this object. Okay? So press run, and here we get all the information that we have inside the object that we have just created. The model one, by the way, here in the workspace, a new object has appeared, which is called model one. Model one, which says it's a list of 12 things, and if we press here, we get the things that are inside this object. This is the information that we have in the object, which is called model one. Okay, let's review what we have inside the object. Here we're going to see it better. On the one hand, we have the coefficients. The coefficients are the alpha and the beta. So we have the information on the coefficients. Okay, we have the residuals. The residuals are the differences between the real values for y and the estimated values for y. You remember this? The residuals, the differences between reality and the prediction. This is inside the object. It has been computed. It's there. We don't need to do anything else to compute them. They are computed. We have the effects. Okay. We have the rank of the matrix that R has inverted to compute the coefficients. We have the fitted values. So the estimated values have been computed. We don't need to compute them. They have been computed. We have a QR decomposition. This is quite a mathematical thing. Don't worry about this. We have the degrees of freedom for the residuals. We have more things, okay? We have lots of things here. And now, if we want to extract these things from the object, we need to use the following idea. These commands that we have here help us extract the information from the object. So if we write model.1, which is the name of the object, then a dollar sign And then coefficients, we're going to get the coefficients, which are the alpha and the beta. If we write model.1 dot fitted values, then we're going to get the estimations for the prices of the houses. If we write model.1 dollar residuals, then we're going to get the residuals. Okay, so let's do this. Much easier than if we use Excel, because everything has been computed just with one line, the LM function. Okay, so now we run this and we get here the coefficients. This is the alpha, 165. Is it okay? Is the same result as we get, the same result we got with Excel? This is the coefficient for size. So the model is the expected price of a house is 165 plus 2.2 times the size. Okay? Then the fitted values. Here we have the fitted values. These are the fitted values. So these are the estimations for the prices. And the residuals, that is the differences between reality and the prediction for our model. Okay, so everything has been computed. For instance, now if we want to compute the residual sum of squares for our model, well, we have the residuals of our model, which are called model.1 dollar residuals. We don't have to write residuals. If we write res, it's enough. That's enough. With this, R understands that we want to extract the residuals. So if we want the residual sum of squares, what do we need to do? We have the residuals, we square them, and then we add everything. So if we write this thing, sum model.1 dollar reg, sorry, res squared, we're going to get RSS. This is what we get here. This is the residual sum of squares. That is the global error that we have when we use size to predict the price of the house with this command, with this one. And we got nothing because we have assigned the result to an object which is called rss.1. So if we want to know how much is it, we need to write rss.1. And that's the residual sum of squares. Is it the same we got with Excel? Yes. So we have here the residual sum of squares with size is 1018.182. Okay. Perfect. Any questions so far? Is it okay or are you lost? Is it okay? Okay. Then, the next thing we did was to use a simpler model. The simpler model was the one without size. And that's what we do here. In this part of the script, I write here, this is the model without size. So that's the way to tell R that we want to estimate price with no variables at all. Here we say, I want a linear model to estimate price, and the set of variables you have is just a 1, which is the same as a constant. We have a constant. We are telling R, I want you to estimate price with a constant, and then R is going to compute the average, of course. Of course. So if we do this, Model.0 is the simplest possible model, the model without variables. And if we compute in the next command the residual sum of squares for this model number 0, we're going to get the residual sum of squares without size. Okay? So RSS without size, or if you like, we can write it like this, empty set. We have no variables here, so we have the empty set. Okay. And now, let's see which the value for RSS0 is. This is the value for the RSS without size. Is, where is it? Here. 33,667.2. Okay? That's the same value we got with Excel, but much easier because everything has been computed for us. And now, the last step is to compute R squared, the coefficient of determination, which is the difference
between the RSS, the RSSs divided by the biggest one, which is the RSS without size. So if we compute R squared, we get a value, sorry, we get a value for R squared, which is 0.97, which is the value we got. Okay, that's linear regression with R. Of course, we could do more things. For instance, we could plot a line on the plot that we have here to try to get the best line, and we will see this later. Questions so far? Questions? Okay. This is the simplest version of linear regression, because here we have just one feature. We have just one feature to explain the price. But you know, if we have more features, our prediction will be better. So let's do that. Let's try to use more data to get a better prediction for price. And that's what we do here. Now we have more data. We know the number of rooms. We know the size of the houses, but also we know the number of rooms that each house has. And these values are smaller. The first house has 3, the second one 3, 4, 2, and 5. So let's use this data to get a better prediction. And for sure, we are sure that if we use this data, our prediction is not going to be worse. It's going to be at least as good as it was just with size. So knowing the number of rooms is not going to harm our model. The R squared that we're going to get is going to be better than this one. Maybe a little bit better, but better than this one. R squared is never going to go down if we add an invariable to a model. Okay? So let's do this. Let's do this. Now we have this value, number of rooms. So let's enter this data. A new object appears here. And now we're going to estimate our second model. Which is the form of the model? It's a question for you. Size and number of rooms. Yeah, it's going to be an intercept, which is called alpha as before, and then we have plus. First size. It's going to be the first variable that was here before, so it's going to be beta, but now we need a subscript, beta 1, because that's the first variable, and then we're going to have plus beta 2 times number of rules. And of course, plus the error term that's always there. Okay, and now this is not a line anymore. This is not a line, because if we just have one variable, the size, then this equation that we have here represents a line. But now that's not a line. What is this?
Telling R
that we want a linear model to predict the price with two features, which are on the one hand the size and on the other hand the number of rooms. That's the way we tell our idea. We write the name of the feature we want to estimate, which is price, then the pivot, and then the list of factors with a plus sign between them.
So we have price, tilde, size, plus rooms. That means use size and number of rooms to estimate price. And the information that you get from this linear model, please save it into an object which is called model number two, model two. Okay? Model two. So let's run this. And R runs this command. And it creates an object which is called model 2, and the object appears here in our workspace. And now we're going to see what's inside this object. So let's see which the coefficients are. The coefficients are these coefficients. So this is the value of the door, which has not changed a lot. It's very similar to the one we had without number of rooms. So the price of the door is more or less the same in one model and in the other model. This is the effect of size. So this is the effect of increasing the square meters in one square meter, keeping number of rooms constant. And then here we have the effect of number of rooms, which is negative. Any explanation? Any possible explanation? Yeah, that means that if we have more rooms, the price of the house is lower. Or not?
It's keeping the size constant.
Keeping the size constant. So maybe a possible explanation might be, okay, increasing the number of rooms, but keeping the size constant means that the rooms are smaller and they are not as valued by the market, so we decide to, well, reality is that we have invented this data and everything is made up, so we made up the data, so, but it might be a good explanation, no? Number of rooms increases, but as the size is the same, then the rooms are going to be smaller. So we need to interpret the coefficients, but always thinking that this means the effect of increasing the number of rooms, but don't forget, keeping everything else constant, ceteris paribus, keeping everything else constant. Okay, questions? Now let's compute, directly we can compute the RSS, and I bet that the RSS.2, that is the residual sum of squares for this model, is going to be smaller, I'm sure, is going to be smaller than RSS1. Because with RSS2 we have two features, number of rooms and size, and with RSS1 we just have one. So I'm sure it's going to be smaller. Or at least it's not going to be bigger. Let's compute this directly. And RSS2, sorry, I don't know. And here RSS2. Is 453. So RSS with size and rooms is going to be 453.435. So we have reduced the global error, so adding a number of rooms seems to be a good idea, because the error has gone from here to here. Well, size is a bigger explanator than number of rooms, but it's a good idea to add number of rooms to the equation. Okay. Perfect. Well, it was a wild guess.
But I compared another model with
number of rooms.
Yeah, And well, it was, but
yeah, that was a well guess, because the change here, there is a very big change from here to here, but maybe the change from here to just rooms is quite big also. I don't know. With this information, I could compute it, but it's not an easy exercise to compute the difference between RSS 0 and RSS rooms. We can compute it.
I created another model.
Yeah, yeah. If you create the other model, yes. Which is the value for RSS rooms? Sorry?
8,000 and 50?
15.
15.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, it's much worse. This is a better model than this one. But with the information I had here, it was a wild guess. I said, okay, more or less, the reduction here is very big, so it seems to be a very good explanator.
In this new model, the beta for rooms is positive.
It's positive, yeah. That's quite logical. Mm-hmm. The bigger the number of rooms, but we don't know nothing about size. The bigger the number of rooms, the bigger the price. It's quite logical. Okay. You might be thinking, we need to work a lot in R in order to get very common information. For instance, the R square is very easy to obtain, a very common measure. It seems a little strange to have to compute these things, all these things with these commands. Okay. And reality is that things are much easier than we have done here. If you write summary model.0, you get almost all the information that you need. For instance, with model number 0, you remember model number 0 was the model without size and without rooms. Here we get that the estimate is 440. We get the error for this estimation. You know what that means. This is the standard error of this value here. We get the t-value, and we get the probability of this value of being, the p-value. Sorry, I didn't remember the name for this. This is the p-value. So just writing summary and the name of the model, you get the information for this model. Let's do it with model number 1, for instance. We have computed model number 1, we computed it with this command here. Model number 1 was computed with this command. You remember this? We created model number 1 with the lm function. And now, if we write here, summary model 1, we get the information for model 1. We get the residuals, we get the coefficients, which are this one and this one, the coefficient for the intercept, the coefficient for size. We get the standard error. I'm going to talk a little bit about this. We get the t-values and the p-values for these coefficients. Okay? And for instance, for model number 2, we just need to write summary model number 2, and we get the information for this model with two variables. We get the estimation of the intercept, the coefficients for size and rooms, the standard errors, the t-values, and the p-values. That's the typical output we get when we use SPSS. So, if we want to perform a linear regression with R, we just need a couple of commands. The first one is the one when we create the object, which is something like this, model number 3, an arrow, and then lm, the name of the feature we want to estimate, price, then the sign, which is the tilde, and the names of the features, which are size and rooms, and with this command we create the model, and then we just write summary model 3. Sorry, I forgot the dot. Model.3. And we get this information. So we need a couple of commands. But the advantage here is that we know that inside this object, which is called model 3, we have much more information than the information that we can get with SPSS. So if we're interested in plotting the residuals, for instance, or we're interested in plotting the fitted values against the residuals, we can do it because we have all this information into the object. We can get the standard output this way with just these commands, but always keeping in mind that inside the object model.1, model.2, model.3, inside the object there is much more information we might be interested in. Okay?
The standardized coefficients of the regressive model.
I don't think R computes them by default, but you can do it. Standardizing, you mean the betas, the typical betas? Okay, yeah, you can compute them normalizing every variable and computing the standard model like this, and the coefficients you get are the betas, the standardized betas. Let's spend a little time with this thing here. Everyone knows what these values here mean. Everyone knows what these values mean. These are the estimations, you know, the price of the door, the effect of size, and the effect of rooms. And these values here, what does this standard error mean? Or for instance, this one or this one. The third one, this 18. What does this 18 mean? Anyone knows? This standard error are a measure of the uncertainty that we have on this estimation. Okay? The model says, if I need to give you one value for the effect of number of rooms on the price of the house, this number is minus 28. But I'm not sure about this value because this value is an estimation. This value has been computed based on 5 points, just 5 points, very few points. So this estimation is not going to be very accurate. We have an uncertainty on this estimation. Well, this is a measure of the uncertainty we have. It's 18. That means that this value here might perfectly be this value plus 18, this value less minus 18. It can be there. Okay, so we want these values to be small or big? We want these values to be small, because if these values are small, then that means that the uncertainty that we have on these coefficients is small. We want these values to be small. Okay, so for instance, if we say here, okay, number of rooms has an effect of minus 28 and size has an effect of 2.9. So it seems as if the effect of number of rooms is bigger than the effect of size. But is it true? That's the idea behind the betas also. Is it true or not? It isn't true. Because the uncertainty that we have on this value is small if we compare this uncertainty with this uncertainty. For instance, R's estimation on the effect of size on price is 2.94 and the uncertainty is 0.50. This uncertainty is much smaller than this one. But not in absolute terms, but compared to the coefficient or the estimation. I mean, let's suppose that we have here an estimation of 2.9 and here a standard error of 10. What does it mean? Or with round numbers, we have an estimation of 3 and a standard error of 10. What does it mean? Claro, it means that we are not sure about the real value of this coefficient. It might be 3 minus 10, that is minus 7, or it could be 3 plus 10, which is 13. So we don't know even if the effect is positive or negative. We have no idea on the effect we had in this situation. We will have no idea on the real effect on size on price, because the uncertainty is huge compared with the estimation. That's not the case here, because here this is the estimation and this is the standard error. So the standard error is much smaller than the estimate. And something similar happens here. But if we compare this with this, this value compared with this is smaller than this value compared with this. Where do we see it? Here, in the next column, the t-value. The t-value, what does this column measure? The t-value, which is the t-value? The name t-value is because this t, this is a statistic, and this t follows a student's t. And that's because, that's why it has this name, t-value. But what does this value here means? What does this mean?
It assesses whether the coefficient is different from zero.
Yeah. It measures if the coefficient is different from zero. It measures how many times do I need to move this distance from here to get number zero. So this coefficient measures how far is this number from zero, but measured in terms of this unit. How many times do I need to move this amount from here to get number zero? And why number zero? Because zero means that there is no effect. So if we are at this point, at point 2.94, and we need to move to zero, suppose that the table is number zero, and our step is 0.50, we need more or less 6 steps. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So we are more or less 6 steps from zero. We are very sure that this value is very different from zero. Do you understand this? Okay, what happens here? We have an estimation which is minus 28, so we are there. Positive numbers, negative numbers. Okay, it's the opposite for you, but we're at minus 28. And our step now is 18. We have a longer step. So how many steps do we need to take in order to move from minus 28 to zero? If our step is 18, 1.5. 1.5. So which is farther from zero? This one or this one? If we look just this value, which is closer to zero? If we look just at this value, this is closer to zero. But if we look at this value here, which measures how many steps, how many this size steps we are from zero, then which is closer to zero? This one. Okay? So the confidence the confidence that we have on this value is much smaller than the confidence that we have on this value. So here we see that size is a better predictor for price than the number of rooms. And this information we got from here, from this column. And usually we don't look at the intercept, because the intercept has to be there. We need the intercept for the plane, in this case, to go as close to the points as possible. So we forget about the intercept, we just interpret the coefficients for size and for rooms, for the variables. Okay? And now we have a last column, which is the... Yeah. Yes. Yes.
So the question
Yeah. Here, I will delete number of rooms. Yeah, I think in this model number of rooms is not a good feature to predict price. I would delete it from the model, and I will say why. But we need a little bit of time. Okay. So far, any questions? Anyone understands this column, and this column here? The coefficient, the uncertainty, and the number of steps that I need to take from where I am to zero if the step is this long. Okay? So the bigger the t value, the idea is the bigger the t value in absolute terms, in absolute value, the better the feature is. So here, the better feature is, the best feature is this one. Size. Yes, you had one question.
For the estimate standard, first column, it can be like the value of the beta. Because, for example, the size, it is 2.94.
Yeah.
And if we look into the value of the beta, we can find it is most close to it.
This is the value of the beta. This is the value.
It can be the value.
It is the value of the beta. It is the value of the beta. But this is an estimation of the value. And we have an uncertainty, and this is measured here. So we need to interpret the couple of values together. Not just look at the beta, but also the uncertainty we have. And these two values are summarized here. So if you want, if you just have one value, and this value is the t value, then you have more information than if you have just one or this one. Because here, you know how many steps you need to take from your estimation to zero with this step length. So here we see, just looking at this column here, we see that the size feature is better than number of rooms. Okay, and we have the last column, which is the p-value. And what's the p-value? Well, there are lots of definitions for the p-value. Some of them are correct, some of them are not. Some of them are understandable, and some of them are not understandable. I will try to give you a definition which is not perfectly correct, but which is understandable. Well, it's perfectly correct, it's not complete, if you want. Well, my definition for me, the p-value is a measure of compatibility between two things, one hypothesis and one evidence. For me, this is the p-value. This is how I always teach the meaning of the p-value. We're trying to measure if two things are compatible or not. And we have an index of compatibility. And these two things are, on the one hand, a hypothesis, which says the variable is useless. This is the hypothesis that we have on the one hand. The variable that we are considering is useless. And the second thing that we have is evidence. And the evidence that we have is the coefficient that we have just computed. This coefficient here, with this error, or if you like, this t value, which summarizes all the evidence that we have on this feature, which is called size. So for instance, for the first variable, this p-value, 0.02, is a measure of compatibility. It's an index of compatibility between these two things. A hypothesis that states size is useless. We shouldn't use size to predict price because it's useless. And then the second thing we have is the evidence, which we can summarize in the t-value of 5.851. And then, putting these two things together, we get a p-value, the p-value, which is 0.028. Well, this is the idea. This compatibility index goes from 0 to 1 because it's a probability. It goes from 0 to 1. So 0 means that these two things are completely impossible to be together. They are not compatible at all. That's the meaning of 0. And the meaning of 1 is that these two things are perfectly compatible. So here we have this value, 0.028, which is very close to 0 or to 1. It's very close to 0. So the idea is these two things are not compatible. The compatibility index that we have computed is very, very, very small. So what are we going to do? They can be together in the same universe. So we need to reject one of them, either the evidence or the hypothesis. What are we going to reject? What we are seeing with our eyes, that is the evidence, or a hypothesis that we have? The hypothesis we have. So we're going to say, forget about this. We can say that the variable is useless. So the variable is useful. Let's use size to predict price.
But evidence can be biased.
Yes, of course. But bueno, well, we suppose that the data has been gathered correctly.
I mean that there is a lot of controversy now.
Of course, of course. This is, well, there is a lot of controversy about this way of reasoning. But in order to understand the controversy, that we need to understand the way to do. So this p-value means that. Now we have one question. Okay, 0.028 is very small. But what's very small? What's not so small? Where is the limit?
For t value, what is the criteria to say it's small?
Yeah, that's the question. This p value is small. Well, it depends. It depends. But it depends on what? It depends on you.
No, but I mean the t value.
Well, the t value is big in this case, but the t value depends on the number of observations. So we shouldn't try to find or to establish a threshold for t values. We should try to establish a threshold for p values, because p values are not dependent on the sample size. So let's forget about t values and let's talk about p values. The idea is that depending on you, depending on the person that's going to make the decision of rejecting or accepting this hypothesis here, that's you who are going to decide on the limit of the p-value being big or being small. And this decision is called the significance level. Have you heard about the significance level? The significance level is a decision you make. Significance level is not a value you get from a computer. What you get from a computer is a p-value. And then, or before, you make a decision on your significance level. And it might change. Maybe today your significance level is 0.01 and tomorrow is 0.05. It can change, depending on lots of things. There are some usual significance level. Significance level. Significance level is a threshold that you decide on and means that it's called alpha, usually. Nothing to do with this alpha here. It's called alpha. And that means that if the p-value is here, you're going to say that the p-value is too small, so this hypothesis and this evidence are not compatible, so you're going to reject or accept this hypothesis. You're going to reject the hypothesis, and you're going to say that the variable is useful. So small p-values like this one, small p-values like this one, mean that this variable is useful. And if your p-value happens to be here, then you're going to accept this hypothesis that states that the variable is useless. So big p-values mean that this variable is useless, and you shouldn't use it as a factor for explaining, in this case, the price of the house. So here, if we just look at the p-values, we can say that size is a good predictor and number of rooms isn't. Some usual alpha levels, significance level, are 0.10 or 0.05, I think this is the more used one, and 0.01. But I don't like to say this, because everyone can choose their significance level every day. And today, I woke up this morning and I decided that my significance level today was 0.01. That's true. Yeah, we change significance level when we don't get 0.01, and then we decide to change it to 0.05 because it's easier to get this result. Yeah. Okay, questions about this? Just one more thing before the break. As you remember, we have the information for our models in objects, which are called model 1, model 2, and so on, and so on, and so on. No, that's not what I wanted to do. Yes, that is what I wanted to do. Sorry, no. Forget about this. And then, besides this information about the coefficients and the errors and the t-values and the p-values with this summary, here we have the information on multiple r-squared. This is the r-squared, the coefficient of determination. And we have an adjusted r-squared. Have you heard about this? Adjusted r-squared? Do you know what it's?
The SPSS is the coefficient in the population. One is in the sample of your study, and the other one is in the.
Well, the adjusted R squared is a way to try to correct what happens with R squares. What happens with R squares? Always, when you add a new variable to a set of variables, R square is going to go up. Always. So adding noise, adding a variable which is almost noise, I mean, which explains nothing new, is going to increase a little bit the R squared. So if we rely on the R squared to decide which is the best model, then we might say, okay, as the R squared has increased, I'm going to choose as the best model the one with the biggest R squared. I mean, let's compare models 1 and 2. If we compare models 1 and 2 with summary model 1, we got an R square of 0.9698, and the same thing with model 2, we get 9865. So if we look just at R squared, we might decide that the model number 2 is better than model number 1, because the R squared is bigger, is much bigger. It has increased from here to here. Okay. But what does this adjusted R squared do? Well, it tries to adjust this idea by penalizing the number of variables that the model has. So if we add a new variable to a model, the R squared increases, but the adjusted R squared has two effects. On the one hand, it increases because R squared has increased, but on the other hand, it decreases because the number of variables that we have is bigger. So here, we have penalized the R squared because we have two variables instead of one. Well, here the decision will be the same because even the adjusted R squared is bigger in this model than in this model. So the decision will be the same. This model seems better than this one. But this is the idea behind adjusted R squared, trying to penalize more complex models. And we're going to talk about this because we don't like complex models. We want our models to be as simple as possible. We need to talk about this, and we will do in the following sessions, okay? So this is the idea behind adjusted R squared. And finally, here there is another hypothesis test about the quality of the global model. I mean, here, with this p-value, we have a test for the quality of size. With this p-value, we have a test for the quality of rooms as explanators from price. But here, with this p-value here, we have a test for the quality of the set of variables, that is, size and rooms, to explain price. And the hypothesis is, in this case, the hypothesis is the set of variables is useless. You shouldn't use this set of variables to explain price, but the whole set of variables is useless. This is the hypothesis that we have here. And the evidence that we have is summarized in this F value, which is the F value here, the F statistic, which is a value which is computed with these RSSs that we computed there. We don't care how it is computed. But the idea is that the bigger this number, the better the model. So again, if the p-value is small, is smaller than our significance level, we are going to say, okay, my model as a whole is useful. And if the p-value is big, we're going to say my model as a whole is useless. So here, with this output, the first thing I will do with this output is look at this. At this p-value. Because first of all, I want to test the quality of my model as a whole. The whole set of variables that I have. And then I will say, okay, I have a global p-value which is very small. Not significant at 0.01, but significant at 0.05, so it's a good model. Okay, let's look at the variables one by one. And then I will say, okay, size seems to be a good factor to estimate price, and rooms doesn't seem to be a good variable to predict size. So, as this happens, probably I will delete this variable, and I will keep the model that has size, just size and no rooms, to estimate price. Well, it depends. If you remember, we talked about an inference situation and a prediction situation. In an inference situation, we're interested in the relationship between variables. And maybe, in this situation, I will delete number of rooms. If I'm interested in prediction, what I want is predict as accurate as possible. And if I have rooms, my prediction is going to be more accurate. So maybe if I am in a prediction situation, maybe I will keep this variable here. But final message, the idea is, first of all, we look here, we see if globally the model is good or not. And this happens when the p-value is small. And then, after we have decided that globally the model is a good one, then we go variable by variable, looking at the quality of the variables. And the good variables, the good ones, are the ones with the smallest p-values. Okay? And to get this, we just need two commands. LM, and then summary. Nothing else. But keep in mind, if you want to know more things, into this object, inside this object, which is called model 1, model 2, model 3, you have much more information that you can access if you want. Okay. Okay, so far we have talked about linear regression, and in linear regression the DV, the dependent variable, has to be a quantitative variable. What we want to predict has to be something which is quantitative. For instance, the price of a house, the GDP for the next semester, whatever. But it has to be something which is a number, something quantitative. But in many situations, what we want to predict is not quantitative, it's something which is qualitative. For instance, in computer science, we are very interested, or we are interested in having a spam filter. And what do we want to do with emails and spam filters? Well, we want to classify an object, which is an email message, in two possible situations, which are called spam and ham. Spam. We got an email, and we want to classify it in spam or ham. If it's a spam, we're going to send to the spam folder. If it's ham, then we're going to read it. Okay, perfect. So here, the dependent variable, the variable we want to predict or estimate, is not a quantitative variable, it's a qualitative variable. It's something which is a y with two values. One for spam, for instance, and zero for ham. Or just the other way around. It's the same. One is defined as one and the other one is defined as zero. Well, to do this, in order to perform this task, we might use linear regression, but we would have some problems. Which is the main problem that we are going to have if we use linear regression to predict a situation like this? To start with, let's think about features that might help us predict if a message is going to be spam or ham. Which might be X's, that's it, that's explanatory variables to try to decide if a message is spam or ham.
The sender.
But what do we measure of the sender?
Email address maybe
in a range.
Issues list.
Sender suspicious. Yes or no. It might be coded as 1, 0. Yes, 1, no, 0. What else? More features that will help us decide if a message is a spam or ham.
Content. What it contains.
The content. Yeah, but what do we measure of content? For instance, the appearance of some words, like
Viagra and Orange.
Yeah. Viagra, yes or no. Mortgage, yes or no. Enlargement, yes or no. and so on. There are some words which are flags that make us think about this message being spam. Okay? So we could set. We could have a set of features that are going to help us predict if this is spam or this is ham. So we might want to create a model like the models that we had before. Something like this. Y equals a coefficient, an intercept, plus beta 1 times x1 times beta 2 plus x2, and so on, plus beta k times xk, plus the error term. Okay, we might think about this. But here we have a problem. Because if we use this model, what are we going to get? These variables here, x1, x2, x3, are coded as numbers. 1, 0s, or maybe the length of the message, which is a number. Here we have numbers. If we use this model and we compute the value here, the estimation that we're going to get is what? It's a number. And is this number bounded or not? The number that we get here with a model like this one, the numbers we get here are numbers that could range from minus infinity to plus infinity. So let's suppose that we enter, we get the model, we estimate the model, the alpha, beta 1, beta 2, and so on, and so on, and so on. And then we use this model to predict if our message is a spam or ham, and the value we get here is, for instance, minus 323. This is not very good news, because we don't know how to interpret this number here. What we have here, what we want, are ones or zeros. So this might be a good idea, but we need to think a little bit more in order to translate the number that we get here into a number that goes from 0 to 1, that moves in this range, inside this range. And to get this, we are going to use a function which is called the sigmoid function. Have you heard about this? The sigmoid function. The sigmoid function is a function whose equation is this. One divided by one plus x minus x, and depending on the values of x, we are going to get a different value for I. These are the values for x that go from minus infinity to plus infinity, and as we change the values for x, we obtain different values for I. And the graph of this function is like this. We got the 1 here, we got the 0.5 here, and it goes like this. This is the sigmoid function. It never touches the 1. It never touches the 0. So what we get with this function is a transformation, a mapping from numbers from minus infinity to plus infinity into numbers from 0 to 1. And that's just exactly what we need. Because if we plug this thing, into the sigmoid function, we are going to get a number between 0 and 1. And this number between 0 and 1 might be interpreted as the probability, as a probability of our message of being a 1, of being a spam. This is the main idea behind the technique that we are going to use in these situations. When we want to estimate something which is not quantitative but qualitative, like an email message being a spam or ham, we use what's called logistic regression. Have you heard about logistic regression before? And the idea is that a logistic regression is nothing else than this. Is a normal, a usual linear regression like this one, plugged into a sigmoid function. So the equation finally turns to be like this. The estimation is not alpha plus beta 1 times x1, so on and so on, but 1 divided by 1 plus so it's just like a regular linear regression with the coefficients, this is the linear part, but plugged into the sigmoid function. This way we get something linear. The number we get here is something from minus infinity to plus infinity, but when we plug this number here, we get something which is between 0 and 1, and the number that we get is the probability of being a 1. In our case, the probability of being spam. That's the idea behind logistic regression. Questions? Do you understand this?
I don't understand why in our example the y is not bounded, because if you put all zeros, you have the...
Sorry, where? Why in our example?
Yeah.
Okay. In our example with these three variables.
Or more, but zero and one.
Yeah, but here we could have, for instance, x4, length of the message, number of characters of the message. And number 5, I don't know. And then the coefficients that we have here might be minus 275. So there is no reason for the number you get here to be bounded between 0 and 1. The number you get when you apply this equation to the data that you have here.
For instance, with those three variables, it is bounded because it's just 1 and 0. The lower bound would be all zeros and the...
No, because the coefficients here might be negative. And when, yeah, if you have here 1, 1, 1, and you have here this beta 1 is minus 73, and this beta 2 is plus 84.
Yeah, but you can...
Well, it's bounded.
Yeah.
But it's not bounded in the range you need.
Yeah, but knowing that it's bounded, for instance, the lower bound is minus 500,
mm-hmm.
and the highest bound
yeah.
is 500.
Yeah.
You could, instead of using this, use a linear.
Of course. This is not the only choice. This is one possible choice. The sigmoid function maps numbers from minus infinity to plus infinity to the range 0, 1. But there are different options. For instance, if you know that your function, that the value that you are going to get here is bounded between minus 500 and plus 500, you might decide to decide that the probability, the number, is going to be to get a 0.5 here, and then linear here, and linear here. So this is a linear transformation, and that's perfectly possible. But it's not very used. This is much more general than this one. But you can do this, yes, of course. The idea is to map values which are not between 0 and 1 into values which are between 0 and 1 in order to interpret the value that you get here as a probability. That's what we want. How we do this? This is one way to do this. This is another way to do this. But the most usual one is this one, using the sigmoid function. Okay? More questions? Then there's another thing. Why have we defined 1 as a spam and 0 as sum? This is completely arbitrary. We might have decided to do this the other way around, and defining ham as 1 and the spam as 0. Then the coefficients estimated here will be different, and this will be the probability of being a 1. But in this case, a 1 will be not spam, but ham. Okay. It's the same. The estimation will be different, but our model will be the same in terms of the ability of this model to predict. So this definition here is completely arbitrary. No problem. We could assign a 1 to spam or a 1 to ham. Perfect. Okay, so far, so good. But the problem is, how do we estimate the alpha, the beta 1, the beta 2, and the beta gamma? Before, in linear regression, we had a very simple formula to do this. Well, very simple. If this is a simple linear regression with just one variable, you remember the formula that said covariance between variance and then the other one. And if it's not a simple linear regression but a multiple linear regression, we had the other formula, which was I wrote before, which is this formula that computes The coefficients, you don't know to, you don't need to know this, no problem. But there is a formula that computes the values for the coefficients. There is a formula that analytically computes the values. In logistic regression, there is no such formula. There's no such formula. So, what do we do when we don't have a formula to compute the values of the coefficients? We use what? What do we use? We use another methods. And which are the methods we use when we don't have an analytic formula to compute analytically things?
Numerically.
Numerically. We need to compute things numerically. For instance, if we want to compute the minimum of a function, and we know that this function is y equals ax squared plus bx plus c, we know that to compute the minimum that we have here, what we have, what we need to do is to compute the derivative of this function with respect to x. This is 2ax equals 0. Sorry. 2ax plus b equals 0. And then x is minus b divided by 2a. And here we have the minimum of this function. So we have a formula to compute the minimum for this function. But we have some other methods to compute the minimum of a function. One method to compute the minimum of a function is called gradient descent. We are not going to cover this method, but I want you to understand that so far we had some formulas that computed things exactly, analytically, and we're not going to have these formulas anymore. From now on, things are going to be computed numerically. So they are approximations. And in computing these approximations, R is going to need some time, and they are going to be, again, approximations. Okay? Okay. And why is that? Why don't we have a formula to compute things analytically? Because the function that we need to minimize is not as simple as the one that we minimized in linear regression. Do you remember what we minimized in linear regression? If you don't remember, I'm going to remind you right now. In linear regression, we said, okay, we want the difference between reality and the estimation to be as small as possible. So we had, on the one hand, reality, which was this. This is reality. The real price of the house, on the one hand. On the other hand, we had the estimation. We wrote like this, with a hat. This is y hat. And then we say, okay, this is the deviation for one observation. Reality minus estimation. Some of them are going to be positive, some of them are going to be negative. In order to get everything to add up to the difference between reality and estimation, let's square them and let's add them up. And this was the residual sum of squares. We have the sum of squares between the for the residuals. It's called the residual sum of squares. And this function is a very good function in the sense that it has a minimum which is very easy to compute. It's like this one. It's a function which is concave. And it's very easy to compute the minimum for this function. And we can compute it exactly with analytical methods. Well, in this situation, in logistic regression, the function is not as easy as this one. It's similar to this one, but not as simple as this one. Let's think a little bit about, let's spend a few minutes presenting the function that we want to minimize. So again, we could have here, I'm going to write it, spam one and ham zero. And in a concrete data set, we're going to have some spam messages and some ham messages. So let's suppose that we have some spam messages, some ones, and some zeros. And keep in mind that our goal is to estimate these values for alpha, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, beta k. That's what we want. We want to find values for these coefficients. Because once we have obtained this function, then if we have another email, we can look at its features, substitute the values here, compute this number, and get the probability of this message being ham or spam. Okay, so let's think a little bit. We know that this function is going to give us numbers between what and what? Between 0 and 1. Okay, we are sure, because this is the sigmoid function, so it doesn't matter which number we get here, this is going to give us number between 0 and 1. Okay, 1 meaning that there is a very big probability, 1 or numbers close to 1, meaning that there is a very big probability of this number being spam. And zeros meaning that there is a very big probability of this number, of this email, being ham. Okay, so we need to think about a function that captures this idea. We want to penalize, let's call this, instead of y, let's call this g. Okay? This is the y, this is the real value, and this is the estimation, which is going to be called g. If I have a number like 0.03 here, that's good news or bad news? This is because my model is very bad. Why is that? Because this mail, which is really spam, has been assigned a very low probability of being spam. The same happens here. If I got a 1 here, and the g that I get for this value here is 0.02, that means that this message that we have here, which is really spam, has been assigned a very low probability of being spam. And so on and so on. And the same happens here. If I have a 0 and here I have a 0.92, that means that my model is very bad, because this message, which is ham, is considered as almost sure spam. So we want to penalize what? Think a little bit about what we want to penalize. We don't want to get a situation like this. We don't want to get small values for ones and big values for zeros. Okay? We don't want this. Because if we get something like this, small values for ones and big values for zeros, that means that our model is rubbish. We want just the opposite. What we're going to get are big values for spams and small values for hams. Yes? You see that? These are spams and these are hams. Okay. So what can we do? We do something like this. Have you heard about the logarithmic function? If this is x and this is log x, what's the shape of this function? The logarithm of a number. If a number is negative, the logarithm is defined? No, it isn't defined. The logarithm of a negative number is not defined. In order for a number to have a logarithm, it has to be positive. And It goes something like this. It goes something like this. And the value that we have here is 1. Okay, this is the logarithm of a number. It's not defined if the number is negative. It's just defined if the number is positive, and it goes like this. The logarithm is negative for numbers between 0 and 1. It's just 0 for 1, and then it's positive for numbers bigger than 1. This is the logarithm of a function. Okay? Let's forget about this part of the logarithm. And let's consider just this part here. Let's consider this part here. Now I want you to think about the function minus logarithm of x. This is the logarithm of x, so the function minus logarithm of x is just this, but here up, so it's something like this. Sorry for the poor drawing. Something like this. It goes to infinity. Something like this. This function here is minus logarithm of x. Okay? So, if the number we get here is close to 1, we get 0 as the minus logarithm of x. And if the number that we have here is close to 0, we get infinity. Perfect. This is the idea there. Minus logarithm of x. Okay, with this, any question about this? Sorry. Esto va aquí, ¿no? Goes here? I think so. Ah, bueno, pero no ha pasado nada. Porque es del ordenador. Vale. Lo dejo así. Vale. Any question about this? No? Okay. Let's think about another function, which is this one. Here we have x again, and here we have logarithm of 1 minus x. Logarithm of 1 minus x. And just we're going to think about this function just here, between 1 and 0. This is 0, this is 1. How is the logarithm of 1 minus x? Remember that this is logarithm of x. This one is logarithm of x. So how is going to be logarithm of 1 minus x? It's going to be like this. This is logarithm of x, logarithm of 1 minus x, for instance. When x is 0, 1 minus x is 1, so logarithm of 1 minus x when x is 0 is like logarithm of 1, so it has to be here. It's just taking this 1 and turning it this way. Okay? It's taking this function here and swapping it this way. So this is logarithm of 1 minus x. And just to finish, how is going to be minus logarithm of 1 minus x? It's just taking this function here and swapping it like this. So we're going to get something like this. Perfect. These two functions here, this one and this one, are the functions that we're going to use to create the function that we're going to minimize. Because what happens? Remember, if we have ones, We want to penalize small numbers. If we have zeros, we want to penalize big numbers. And this is the cost function. This is the function that we are going to use to penalize. What are penalizing here? Small numbers or big numbers? If this is the cost, here, the cost of big numbers is very, very low, very small. And the cost of small numbers, remember, our numbers are always between 0 and 1. This is 0 and this is 1. So this function here is penalizing what? Penalizes what? Small numbers. Small numbers. And that's what we want to penalize when? In this situation. Is the one that we are going to use if y equals 1. Okay? And this function here, if the value we get is a 0, then it's not penalized. If the number we get is a 1, it's very penalized. So this function, minus logarithm of 1 minus x is, of x, sorry, penalizes big numbers. Big numbers. And that's exactly what we want to do if y equals 0. Because in this situation, we don't want big numbers. Okay, so now we know what we want to do and the two functions that we're going to use. Now we need to put everything together and create the cost function that we're going to minimize. So the idea is, first the idea, and finally, how to put everything together. The idea is, if I equals 1, that is, if we have a spam message, we want to use this thing. This thing. So we are going to compute minus logarithm of, and let's call this g of x. G of x, because it depends on the x's, x1, x2, x3, x4, let's call this g of x. So we compute, because remember, this formula here gives us numbers between 0 and 1, okay? Keep this in mind. So, if y equals 1, we want to compute this. Why is that? Because if I equals 1, we want this to be small. And this thing is penalizing small numbers, what we don't want. On the other hand, if y equals 0, we're going to use minus logarithm of 1 minus g of x. Why is that? Because if y equals 0, we want to penalize big numbers. That's what we get with this function. Okay? So, these are the functions that we're going to use. But we need to add everything up, because we want to minimize globally the total cost for the set, for data set that we have. What can we do to add everything up? We could say, okay, let's compute these numbers for I equals 1, let's compute these numbers for I equals 0, for spams and for hams, and make this a minimum. But that's very difficult to create a function. What can we do? We can do the following. We could say, okay, let's take this one here, minus log of gx, and let's multiply by I. in the ith case, in case number I. So let's take observation number I, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and if it and if this observation is a span, this is going to be a 1, so it's going to be multiplied by the logarithm of the result of putting xi into this formula there, okay? Plus minus logarithm of 1 minus g xi times 1 minus yi. And why is that? Because if we have if we have a span, then what's going to happen if we have a span? If we have a span, this is going to be a 1, okay? And this thing here is going to be 0. So if this is a 1 and this is a 0, this part is not going to be in the equation. And the cost function is going to be just this one. On the other hand, if we have a ham, if yi is 0, then this part here is going to be 0, because this is going to be a 0, but 1 minus yi is going to be 1 minus 0, 1, so the cost function is going to be this one. Okay? So we have put everything together. And this is the function that we are going to minimize. This plus minus becomes a minus. And that's the function that we want to minimize. So now, we need to find the values for alpha, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, beta 4, the coefficients, because that's what we can change in this formula here, the coefficients for these variables here, in order for this cost function, this is called the cost function, to be as small as possible. So this is the same as our famous residual sum of squares, but it's a little bit more complicated, a little bit more complex. And why is that? Because here we don't have an output which is a quantitative thing, and we can't measure the difference between this and this. Here we need to use another cost function. And the problem is that with this cost function, which is not the only one, there are most cost functions, but with this cost function, there is no easy way, there's no way to compute analytically the minimum. And we need to use other methods. That's why we need a computer to do this. We can't do this by hand. Okay? And the method that is used usually is called gradient descent. Okay? This is the idea behind logistic regression. So as in linear regression, there is a cost function. We want to minimize it, but it's much more difficult to find the minimum. But don't worry, because R is going to find the minimum for us. Questions about this? No questions. Okay. So with this procedure, we are able to treat a situation when the qualitative variable that we want to predict has just two possible values, like spam and ham. But what happens if we have a qualitative variable which has more modalities, more possible values, for instance 1, 2, 3, or what happens? Well, let's see what happens in this case. Off. And On Wednesday, we're going to see a data set which is called the IRIS data set, which is very famous. IRIS. And in this data set, we have some flowers, which are called iris. And we have some values for them, which are the sepal and petal length and width. And with this information, with this data on sepal and petal length and width, we're going to predict the species of iris, because there are several species of iris. And these species are called Virginica, Setosa and Versicolor. Versicolor. The name of the flower is iris, but these are species of the flower. So here we have an example of a qualitative variable that we want to predict, which has more than two features. What can we do in order to use logistic regression to classify the flowers? Okay, there are several procedures, different procedures, but we're going to use a procedure which is called one versus all. This is the procedure that we're going to use. And it works as follows. It works as follows. First of all, we classify Virginica versus Setosa and Versicolor. So with this classifier, we're going to find a classifier, we're going to obtain for each flower a probability of being, this is going to be defined as 1 and this is going to be defined as 0. So it's going to be, is it a Virginica or not? So these are going to be ones and these are going to be zeros. And with a logistic regression, we will obtain probabilities of being Virginica. So this is the first classifier that we need to compute. Then we're going to find a second classifier, which is going to be Setosa versus Virginica and Versicolor. Here, Setosa is going to be 1, Virginica Versicolor is going to be 0, and we will obtain what? The probability of what? Of Setosa. Of Setosa, because here, Setosas are going to be 1s, and Virginicas and Versicolors are going to be 0s. And the last step will be to compute a third classifier, which is going to be Versicolor versus everything else, Setosa and Virginica. And here we are going to obtain a probability of being Versicolor. Okay, that's why the procedure is called one versus all, because we compute classifiers for each modality versus everything else. Okay, now we have three probabilities for each flower, and what are we going to do? We have one flower and three probabilities. Which is the class we're going to assign the flower to? Yeah, of course. We are going to assign the flower to the class with the highest probability of the three. Okay? The highest probability. So we select the maximum probability. And this is the class that we are going to assign the flower to. This is called the one versus all procedure. Okay? And that's what we will do on Wednesday. Okay, questions on this? Questions on logistic regression? The general idea is very similar to common regression, but we need the sigmoid function to adjust numbers, to map numbers between 0 and 1. Then the cost function is not as simple as the one we used because of this sigmoid function. We use logarithms to penalize big and small numbers. We get this strange cost function that we minimize with an approximate procedure, which is called gradient descent. And this is the simple example to classify one versus zero. And then if we want to classify things in more groups, into more groups, then we can use something like this, which is like this procedure, which allows us to have 3, 4, 5 groups, whatever we want. Okay? Okay, plan for next class will be finish logistic regression and start talking about overfitting, which is the main problem that we're going to have with supervised learning. The idea behind overfitting, I'm going to talk just 2 minutes about this idea of overfitting, is that in every data set we have some signal and some noise. I mean, in the scatter plot we had before on size and price of the houses, some of the points that we have here, or the position of the points, a part of the position of the point of the points is due to a real relationship between size and price. But some of the position of the points is due to random variation of data. If our model adjusts not only the signal but also the noise, then we are overfitting. We are relying too much on the data. We are relying too much on the data, and this makes that our model is too close to the data, but to this data that we have, and it's not going to generalize well to other data sets. This is the problem of overfitting. So we need to talk about this, and in order to understand this, we're going to see another procedure which is called KNN. Have you heard about K nearest neighbors? It's a very simple procedure, but it's not very used, really, but it's very useful to understand the problem of overfitting. So we're going to use it to understand the problem of overfitting. So plan for next class will be finishing logistic regression, seeing KNN, and then overfitting. And the last class of this part of supervised learning will be to talk about CART and non-parametric methods. Okay. Nothing else. See you on Wednesday.